Perfect. Good evening to, good afternoon, sorry. Good afternoon to everybody. My name is Edgardo Civallero. I'm talking to you from a small village near Madrid in Spain. And I will be talking to you about, let me show you, this. Library services for indigenous societies in Latin America. Okay. Why did I choose this subject for this particular conference? Well, I'm originally from Argentina. Now I live in Spain, but I was born there. I studied librarianship there. I am a librarian. And I work for several years with indigenous communities in my country and in neighbor countries like Chile or Bolivia, trying to create, trying to develop some kind of a library service for indigenous communities, both in the countryside and in urban areas. Okay. The fact is that when you look here, you know, we are talking about dangerous librarianship, a conference by urban librarians. I told to myself, okay, what I am about to tell you is related to urban librarians, because at least in Latin America, most of the indigenous population lives now in urban areas, in cities or around cities. And second, it's a dangerous, quite dangerous task. And it's dangerous both in the metaphorical and in the literal way, at least in Latin America, okay? So, my initial intention here with this conference was talking to you about trying to make a kind of resume of 20 years of experiences with library services to indigenous population in Latin America. But for 1 hour, that was a lot of information. So what I decided instead was resuming even more, abstracting all the information, and I created like five principles, five main ideas where everything we have done in Latin America is condensed, okay? All our experience, all our problems, all the challenges we found, all the doubts we had are inside these five main ideas, and that's what I want to share with you today, okay? So when we started working in this indigenous librarianship scene, we discovered that there was one idea we have to keep in mind all the time, and that idea was this one. This is a proverb supposedly from Central Africa that says, whatever you do for me, but without me, you do against me. I discovered that the hard way. I made my final work in university designing a basic model for indigenous libraries. And I went to an indigenous community in northeastern Argentina, and I told them, hello, I bring to you the library. And they told me, okay, but we don't need that. And I wondered, wait, how can you tell me that? you need a library. No, we don't. And they didn't. They didn't need the library I was proposing. So I had to take all my work and it went to the garbage. And I started all over again, but this time with them, talking to them in a conversation. Okay, what do you need? What you have, what you would like to have. Okay, and that's very important. That's not important just for when working with indigenous population. I think that for librarians, that should be a basic idea, a must. You have to take into account all the time whoever is the final user, the client, as they call, okay, some people. The final user, you have to keep in mind their needs, their wishes, their reality. Okay, and that's the main idea we found when working with indigenous populations in Latin America. We discovered that all of us librarians who went to indigenous communities to create libraries, we all had what we call the missionary syndrome. We all arrived to communities, to indigenous communities, both in the countryside or in the city, trying to help, yes, but with from our own perspective. And sometimes that's wrong, all of the time. That's wrong. Okay, you have to go there to ask, to see, to watch, to study, to chat. You have to speak with people. That's the main lesson we learn through all the time we have been working with indigenous populations in Latin America. Okay, so I will go now with these five core ideas. Okay. I was about to tell you to interrupt me if you have any doubt, but since we are streaming this conference, please save all your comments, all your questions, and all the discussion for the end. Please hold that question because I'm really interested in listening to you and what do you think about all that. Okay, so I will go with the 5 points, and then we can talk a little bit about them. The first one, let me see if I can share that with you. Mm-hmm. The first one, I call it Libraries for All. I am sure you are familiar with DIV. That's IFLA UNESCO Public Library Manifesto from 1994. The services of the public library are provided on the basis of equality of access for all, regardless of age, race, sex, religion, nationality, language, or social status, and so on. When we talk about libraries, especially about public libraries, we are talking about libraries for everybody, for all kind of users. That's a basic idea in librarianship. The problem is that's not real. Okay, that's very difficult to find actually in real world. Okay, that's why we are talking about indigenous service, indigenous libraries, or as library services for indigenous people. Okay, there are big holes, big gaps in librarianship. There is no libraries for all. There is library for a majority, and this majority is usually the dominant part. Okay, the mainstream part of the society. What's the problem here? Libraries have to deal with few resources, okay, and have to make the best of them. So usually minorities are out of the deal, out of the question. I am talking about Latin America. I am not quite aware about how all these things work in North America, okay? So we discovered that these IFLA UNESCO manifesto wasn't being respected in Latin America, okay, especially for indigenous population, but also for other kinds of so-called minorities. Okay, so the first thing we needed to do was to acknowledge the need of libraries for all, library services for everybody. And that's, even if it's just wording or just words, you know, that's very important to recognize the need, okay, the necessity of library services for everybody, really democratic, really for everybody. That means that in a multicultural society, you have to take into account, you have to keep in mind at least to keep in mind, at least nominally, you know, the need of each one of your potential users. That didn't happen in Latin America, and in some areas of the continent, it still doesn't happen. And as far as I am informed, in Africa and in some part of Asia, doesn't happen either. I could speak also about the minorities, linguistic minorities here in Europe, especially in Spain, whose needs are not covered by libraries either. So you see, it's not just in Latin America, it's everywhere that libraries are not responding to the needs of all the users. And we discovered in Latin America, all the people who have been working with indigenous libraries, that giving that step, going from we don't acknowledge, we don't recognize indigenous people, minorities as potential users, to okay, let's at least think about it, was huge. And it made a big difference in our minds and in our users' minds too, because they got recognized by the library. Their needs got recognized by the library. Okay? So this is one of the ideas we got from all our experiences. We have to give that big step and recognize the need of library services for everybody. Okay? Then things start getting a little bit more complicated. We go get to them. Let me share with you. The second point, the second idea or principle was, I call it we and the others, okay? These are the basic ideas. So, when you are working with different groups in society, through our work, we discovered that we use a lot of labels: indigenous, native, Afro-American. We had a lot of them. And we started wondering if this use of labeling, this use of labels, this putting people just like in jars, you know, here go indigenous, here, what are you? You are Afro-American, okay, you come here. What are you? You are gypsy, okay, you come here. This was becoming kind of a problem, okay? You are creating the other. You are putting some people in front of you. You are creating an artificial gap between you and them, whoever they are. we could talk also not just about these kind of ethnic or linguistic minorities, but also about gender, about all kind of differences where labels are heavily used. Okay. So we started wondering, is that necessary? Is that necessary? Is it necessary to speak, for example, about indigenous libraries, libraries for indigenous peoples, library services? I mean, in the end, we are talking about libraries, you know? And when you go to a library, a public library, common public library, who works, let's say, in the middle of the Andean range in Peru or in Bolivia, okay, and you find there a lot of books in indigenous languages, for example, in Quechua or in Aymara, okay, would you call that an indigenous library, or just a library who is serving the population there who happens to be indigenous? So it got complicated because there were a lot of different situations in Mexico, in Colombia, in Brazil, in Argentina. All our experiences, the experiences of the people who were working in this stuff were different. We have different opinions, but we arrived to a final idea, which is be careful when using labels, okay? Because you may be creating some entity, the other, this indigenous person, this minority person, this Quechua speaker person or something else, which in reality doesn't exist, but just in your mind. And that can heavily influence the design of a library service, okay? The third point, which is this one, I call the exoticism of the difference. How exotic everything different can be to our eyes. So when you are working or when you start to work with indigenous people, both in the countryside, in rural areas, or in cities, you will notice that you are identifying them because they have a kind of particular features, particular traits. Okay, they are unique in their own way. And the point was that while working with this, we discovered that a lot of our own stereotypes and prejudices were influencing that. Okay, so one very funny example is a library that was built in Colombia in the Amazon River basin for I will not remember now what indigenous people it was, but the library was in the shape of a traditional house of these people, you know, with the walls made of bamboo and the roof made of palm leaves and stuff. And most of the people living there asked themselves why they were building a library just like that. The designers thought that it was important for them to feel the library like theirs, so they try to replicate their architecture, but for them, their architecture was not that important, you know? And so the point here is that the stereotypes and the preconcepts, you know, that the builders of this library had about indigenous people heavily influenced their decision. And they created something that in the end was kind of, it wasn't useless, but it could have been better. Okay. While talking with and while working with other colleagues in Latin America, we have found a lot of these kind of problems. You know, librarians that go to work or are working in indigenous areas and have these beliefs that, okay, that, no, indigenous people, they don't read because everything is oral tradition. Okay, yeah, they have a lot of oral tradition, but they also read. We live in 21st to 21st century, for God's sakes. Okay, so leave your stereotype aside and start living where we are now. We have a lot of issues with constructions and with library design. Okay, I remember a library in northeastern Argentina, the walls were covered with masks, traditional masks, and the librarians wanted to make the library more appropriate to indigenous users, but later they discovered that these masks are called aña, and they are used just in a particular feast in the year, and they have a very strong religious meaning, and they were not to be hung in the walls, you know. So all these kind of things that we can think, we think that may represent indigenous cultures, we should be careful. We should be really careful because everything different of what we know, everything which is different of what we live every day might seem kind of exotic, kind of interesting. But at the same time, we can be putting all our stereotypes, all our prejudice, all our preconcepts in the same bag, in this idea. And that's really dangerous. Okay, so that's another point, another idea we came up with while working these kind of experiences. I'm telling you all this, and you may think that everything I'm telling you is just common sense. And yes, it is. But sometimes arrive to these common sense ideas really difficult. It's a really long way. It's done by trying and failing all the time. It's a very hard way to work, and as I say at the beginning, these are ideas after 20 years of work and 20 years of direct experience, and we are still working on it, okay? So, fourth point here. Let me see. Here. The fourth point, I call that library colonialism. That's a very challenging and a very contested idea, at least in Latin America. Library as a tool of colonialism. Okay. We are still discussing about that. We are discussing about decolonializing the libraries in Latin America. And when it comes to library design, we have discovered that's the most important idea you have to keep in mind, okay? No matter where your indigenous users are, if they are far in the countryside, if they are just one block away from you in a big city. That's a very important idea. Libraries can be, have been in the past, and in some parts of the world, they still are very strong tools for colonialism, as are schools. In Latin America, at least in Argentina, in Chile, in Bolivia, and in Peru, libraries have been a very strong acculturation tool, a very strong tool for denying, for making invisible the local cultures and to impose what is considered just like the culture, okay? The official, the important, the mainstream culture. In the end, it all comes to conquest and civilization, okay? And schools and libraries were very important tools and are important and very important tools right now. So when designing a library service for indigenous people or for any kind of minority, first question you have to keep in your mind is this being a colonialist tool? Is this being a tool for domination, a tool for denying another thing? Is this being open enough? Whatever you are doing, okay? If you are creating a library space, if you are designing a collection, if you are writing an acquisition policy, if you are going outside with your library, with a mobile library, whatever you do, this is first thing, okay? And it's quite related with the sentence I presented you at the very beginning, the African proverb, okay? This is keeping in mind that you are working with other people. This is keeping in mind that you have to respect them. You have to respect their culture. You have to respect their ways. You have to be aware that they don't live as we don't live in the 15th century anymore. Okay, you have to understand that things have changed for everybody in this global society. Okay, and you have to act accordingly to all that. So yes, that's the most important part in design, and that's the main problem we have found all around Latin America when working with in this kind of experiences. And one of the main problems we have found was classification tools, bibliographic classification tools. You guys in the States, I guess you use mostly Library of Congress and DWI classification. In Latin America, we use DWI and UDC, Universal Decimal Classification. Until recent times, and I know that because I have worked for Universal Decimal Classification, editorial team changing things inside there. Until recent times, indigenous languages in Latin America were not there. So if you wanted to classify something, you couldn't. You just couldn't. And there was a kind of a division of races that was absolutely racist. There was a kind of invisibility of everything that wasn't Europe, that wasn't Western culture, that wasn't mainstream traits. Okay, so that was a big problem. Please give me one moment because here in Spain it's getting darker and I need a little bit of light. Now that's much better. Yeah. Okay, another problem we found when working with this colonialism scene was that our libraries are heavily based on writing work. Okay, while indigenous cultures, at least in Latin America, are heavily based on another kind of support for the information, okay? Mainly orality, mainly the spoken word, but also a lot of sounds, paintings, and all kind of coded information. We librarians, at least in Latin America, we were not ready for dealing with that. I mean, yeah, you know how catalog and classify CDs and DVDs and all this stuff, but you are not ready to, or you are not instructed, or you are not taught to deal with oral tradition. You are not ready to classify and put in your shelves a facial painting. You don't know how to capture a dance or some symbols or some signs, okay? And this is the very basis for most indigenous cultures, I think in all the Americas. Okay, so we are not ready for that, and sometimes we impose writing on our users, our indigenous users, and we tell them, okay, we will write this down. We will write your tales, we will write your songs, we will print your paintings, we will produce a book. And that's wrong. You are stripping all that information, all that knowledge of a lot of their main parts, and you are making a big mistake. When I started working in Argentina with indigenous libraries, as I told before, I went with a basic, very basic idea, and I have to forget about it and create something new. And what I did create was a sound library. It was very small because the community where I worked was really small. I worked with the local school, which had about 30 children. And I went to the children's houses at evening, at night, to record the grandparents' tales and legends. I had a cassette recorder back in the day, and I recorded all these tales. Okay, so then during the day, I went back to school with the children. I played these tales for them. And it was curious because first thing, they didn't listen to these tales. I mean, they didn't listen to their grandparents at home anymore. There was a big gap between children and grandparents. And second, they reacted pretty well to the recorded sound, but if written, they didn't react so well. I mean, they didn't recognize a lot of stuff that was happening in the recorded version of the tale. So we discovered that, of course, there is a lot of meta information in the spoken word that we cannot reproduce when writing. And that's really important because we are information managers and we have to recognize all the features and all the traits of the information, of the knowledge we are handling. Okay? Libraries in Latin America are just another part of the conquest. They came with the conquerors and they brought with them a language. They brought with them a kind of support, the book, the writing, and a kind of culture, you know, the important culture. Indigenous cultures in Latin America, at least, they work in a very different way. They don't have this important culture. They just keep what they feel to be important by memorizing it and repeating it from generation to generation. Okay, there is no elite, there is no famous writers, there is not such a thing. There are a lot of contents that seem to be important to the community and need to be transferred from one generation to the next. And we librarians have to be a part of that change, a very important part of that change, a very conscious part of that change, that chain, okay? We have to help that information to travel from one generation to the next. And we have to respect the local formats. Okay, we live in the 21st century and indigenous peoples in Latin America and North America and everywhere are using new technologies, are using the internet, know how to play DVDs, know how to use a camera and a cell phone, blah, blah, blah. And that's perfect. And we can use these technologies too, as a tool, okay? As a tool, as an extra tool to help that information to be preserved in a better way and to be dispersed, distributed in a better way too. But we have to keep in mind that we are managing a knowledge that has been transmitted from a lot of time ago until now. It has survived a conquest, it has survived a lot of things. Here they are still talking their languages, they are still transmitting their old legends and tales and traditions. So we have to be extra careful with that. They have gone through a lot of colonialism, they have gone through a lot of things, so we have to be respectful with that. What I am saying here about indigenous people can be applied to a lot of other groups, social groups, ethnic groups, everywhere in the world. So keep it in mind for indigenous people and for the rest. It has to be an attitude, okay? Some open mind in librarianship, okay? To be respectful and to see the other, the person we have in front of us as a person. Okay, no, as something strange, something different, something exotic, okay? Okay, and so we go with the last idea, which I call respect and sustainability. Well, I think during the last minutes, I have been talking actually about respect. This is very important. But we have to keep in mind also that we, most of the times when working with indigenous people, we are working with currently disadvantaged people. I mean, at least in Latin America, they are poor. They suffer a lot of pressure from governments, from police, from military forces, from the rest of the society, okay? They live in areas, sometimes in areas where there are no basic resources, where there are a lot of epidemics and so on. So when creating library services there, we have to keep in mind a basic idea called grassroots development. You go there, you ask them, what do they need? That's first. And we come back again to the African proverb I shared with you at the beginning. You have to go there and you have to ask them, what do they need? And you have to look, how do they live? I have seen extremely expensive libraries in the Andean mountains where there is no electricity. Expensive libraries built there with computers. Nobody knew how these computers will work after the inauguration and the photographies for the newspapers and the politicians and the staff, you know. Nobody knew how these computers will work. Nobody knew how if these computers were broken, how they will be repaired. Nobody realized that this library there in the middle of a village made of mud was like the white elephant in this part of the world. They didn't care, you know? And that's a kind of lack, absolute lack of respect for that people and their problems, because they are living in a situation that needs to be acknowledged, okay? You have to respect that. Okay, you don't need to create a mad library if you are working in a village with houses made of mud. But you have to be aware of the possibilities of these people and of their needs, especially their needs. A lot of library designers, these people who design library services, thinks they know all. They think that whatever they plan, if that's good for us, it's good everywhere. And that's false. You have to go there and you have to ask, okay, what do you need? And trust me, they know what they need. They can't do it, or they don't have the tools or the know-how or the resources to do it, but they are aware of what they need. They are pretty aware of why they need it. And sometimes they are even aware of how to do things. They just need some help. So first, always ask, do you need a library? What do you need? What kind of books would you like? What kind of services? Do you have children? Do you want us to help you record your oral tradition? Do you want us to support your language? Do you want us to provide you legal information for your fights against the government or against whatever you are fighting for? Do you want us to support, to provide you health information, okay, for your epidemics or for your whatever? Do you want us to provide help for your children to complete their education? That's the kind of question we have to do. And whatever we do, it has to be sustainable in time. Okay, no fancy computers if tomorrow they will stop working. That's useless. And that's kind of insulting. Okay, because sometimes these communities, these people have a lot of problems getting their daily food, and you are carrying something they didn't ask for, they don't need. Okay, something that it won't work in the near future. Okay. Well, so closing the ideas, this is what we learn through our work, our experiences in different areas in Latin America. There have been experiences in southern Chile with the Mapuche people. There has been experience in the northeastern Argentina with Com people. I work with them. In Bolivia with Quechua and Aymara people, in Peru with Quechua people too, in Brazil with several people, but the most famous are the Ticuna in the Amazon River. They have a lovely library centers. In Ecuador with some Quechua speaking people too, in Colombia, in Guatemala with Maya peoples, and in Mexico, right now, there are a lot of small experiences going on. Some of these experiences have been funded by governments and national agencies, and other experiences just are librarians that want to try and help their community or communities who decide that they want a library with them and ask for some help and create the library. Sometimes they also create their books. I don't know if you know Cartoneros books. They are books made with cardboard and handmade cardboards. And they prepare and they create their books in their languages with their own stories inside, and they create entire libraries like this. And it's really interesting. Before finishing, I wanted to share with you the name of the artist who made the photographs I have been sharing with you. It's Pierre Scalbert, and the pictures belong to a collection called The Way We Are Now. The pictures were taken in Colombia in 2012. And I'm telling you that because sometimes during my presentations, people tell me, oh, you are showing this typical, stereotypical picture from indigenous people in Latin America. Okay, these are not. These are pictures taken by a photographer who asks these people, okay, how do you want to be photographed? And they told him like this. And these are the images you have been seeing. Okay? And I think that's all I have to tell you. Thank you very much. And now if you have questions or comments, I will be more than glad to answer or to comment back.
Yes, we have a question, Peter.
Okay, wait, give me a minute because I have some problems with my volume here. Okay. Perfect, I'm listening.
Hello, thank you for your talk. Now I have a question that really pertains to the case of, say, the Maya in Guatemala and other indigenous who have been the victims of genocide, say, for example, the Maya on the Rio Smart in the 1980s. In the United States now, there's a big emphasis on librarianship as emphasizing social justice as being a gateway for people to learn about their history and rights, political rights, in order to advance themselves. Do you know of much, if there's much with indigenous peoples, especially the Maya, trying to use the library as a tool to advance themselves socially or to seek justice or vindication? An example of the case of genocide?
Okay, let me recall. Yes, there are other examples. For example, Mapuche people in southern Chile, they are having right now a lot of conflict with Chilean government and private companies about their lands and about their resources. So they are using libraries, both indigenous libraries, let's call indigenous libraries, or even just public local libraries to inform themselves, to collect their knowledge, to collect the information they find valuable, and to use that information to fight back and to support their struggles. And in northeastern Argentina, when I worked, we tried to do the same, but we received serious threats to our personal threats. So we had to stop doing that. In northern Peru, you have the a network of rural libraries in Cajamarca department. They are extremely good libraries. They are small, and they also support the struggles of Quechua people against mining. I'm thinking about some libraries in Brazil, and I am thinking about some libraries in Colombia, in Medellin, for example. I have been there last year in September, and they are supporting indigenous people who have been displaced by the conflict, and they are living in the streets in Colombia, so they are giving them shelter, and they are supporting their struggle for their own land. Okay, as well as they are collecting all their histories, all their stories about being displaced and about the conflict and about the war and about the land. So yes, there are a number of this kind of experience regarding social justice, regarding memory, which is really important, regarding supporting the indigenous struggles. As I said when I started, that's why this kind of librarianship can be sometimes dangerous.
Thank you.
You are welcome.
Any other questions?
That means I have been extremely clear.
Yes. Well, thank you, Edgardo. We should give him one more. Oh, I'm sorry. We have another question.
Perfect.
You go to library school and you hear about indigenous libraries. Like, how do you get involved if you're anyone is interested in, like, you know, getting to know this community and, I don't know, just going ahead and working with them? Like, how do you do that? How do you start to do that?
That's a question I hear a lot. It's difficult. First time I had contact with an indigenous community was in 1997. I was living in northeastern Argentina, and I started visiting a library in a very poor neighborhood outside a big city. It was a very poor neighborhood inhabited by indigenous people. And I started visiting the library, and the librarian there connected me with the teacher in the community. And the teacher connected me with one very old man who told me if I wanted to hear some stories. So I went to his house and we started drinking mate. I don't know if you know what that is. It's an Argentinian drink. And it was early night, and he started talking to me, and he told me, okay, in the beginning, it was very dark. And I didn't know what he was talking about until I realized he was talking about the story of the universe. And he started telling me all the story of the universe, according to his people. It was early morning when he was finishing the story, right in the moment we were. There, I discovered I wanted to work with indigenous people because that was fantastic. With him, with this person, I contacted other people, and I guess that I was humble enough and I was open-minded enough and I was willing enough to work with them, and just slowly, very slowly, doors were open. I learned a bit of the language. I learned to play their music. I learned to eat their food. I learned all their legends and their stories. And I started working with them. And then I guess that this experience made me different, a different person. So this helped me to approach different communities. I mean, other people with other languages and other musics. Okay, but from a different perspective, I mean, a different perspective from my colleagues. Okay, because I have already had experience. And then I think it's simple. You have to be respectful, but respectful like with everyone else. Okay, and you have to be open-minded and ready to learn a lot of things, because there are a lot of things to learn, and you have to be ready to face a lot of bad things because there are a lot of bad things going on there. My advice to everybody to anybody who wants to start with this kind of work: look around you. You will find very close to you some kind of community. Maybe indigenous community, maybe a minority community. Look for schools, look for libraries, look for cultural groups, you know, just like music groups or these kind of things, start contact, start listening, start learning, start speaking, talking to people. And then you will find, suddenly you will find inside the community, and you will discover if you are needed or not, and you will discover what you can do there for you and for them, for both.
Thank you.
That was a great question. Two great questions. Any other questions? Now I'm afraid to shut down. Any other questions? Okay, well, let's...
Thank you very much, and I will try to give the organization a copy of this conference so they can distribute it. So if you want, you will get there my email. If you want to contact me, I will be more than glad to stay in touch. Okay?
Okay, great, and I'll let Laura know. So thank you so much, Edgardo.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, too.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Have a good night.